Hello, Year 10. So today we are going to start our work on homeostasis and response topic. Hopefully you've got all the checklists and everything that you need for this topic. So our focus for today is looking at what we mean by homeostasis and negative feedback. We're only going to look at that very briefly because we're going to come onto that in later lessons in more detail. We're going to be thinking about the conditions in the body that need to be controlled. And then we're going to look at the term stimulus and receptor and what they are, and thinking about our different senses and what stimuli we can detect. So the first thing I'd like you to do is think about these athletes running long distance race. I want you to think about internal conditions in the body that might be changing as a result of the athletes doing the marathon. You know, what will be changing? Why do they need to be controlled? Can you think about what organs are involved in keeping them at the correct level? Try and build up a table to record your ideas. So you can pause the video here and have a think for 5 minutes or so and jot down some ideas. Okay, so here we've got Mo Farah, Paul Radcliffe and Dame Kelly Holmes. So, you know, what would be changing? Well, we need to think about what would be going on in their body. So they're doing a lot of exercise, and you've done the bioenergetics topic, so you know that they'll be doing lots of respiration. And respiration requires an energy source, so they'll be using lots of glucose, at least in the first place, and then other stores afterwards. So their glucose levels in their body will be changing. Respiration releases heat energy, so they're going to be getting hot. Their body temperature is going up. In order to help reduce that temperature, they're going to be sweating, losing water via sweat. So the water concentration in your body needs to be controlled. You'll also have things like salt and iron levels changing, and oxygen and carbon dioxide levels changing. They'll also be building up lactic acid and other toxins. So all of these things are conditions within the body that would be changing and need to be controlled and tried to be maintained. So key factors we talked about then. So glucose is required for aerobic respiration, and actually glucose being in solution also affects water potential of the blood and might affect osmosis, but really importantly, it's required for aerobic respiration. And there are key organs involved in this. Obviously you absorb sugar from your diet in the intestines, but once it's in your body, the pancreas and the liver are really, really important in controlling the levels, and we will look at that in later lessons. Also your muscles as well. Your core body temperature, which is the internal temperature of your body, is important because it's all about enzymes. Okay, so about maintaining that optimum temperature for enzymes that control the rate of reactions going on in your cells. And a key organ involved in controlling your body temperature is your skin. Now your brain is involved in coordinating information, and we'll look at that in detail, but your skin is the main organ in terms of controlling that temperature, as well as also muscles and other things, as we shall see later on. The water content or water potential of your blood is really important because it affects osmosis and movement of water into and out of cells, and how the cells function, where the chemical reactions in going on in solution your cells will function properly. And the key organ that's involved in controlling your water potential are your kidneys, and it should also say skin now, typo, sorry. Because obviously you lose some water in your sweat, but it's a loss rather than a control thing. So if you lose a lot of water through your skin when you're sweating, your kidneys will have to adjust how much water you lose in your urine. And again, we will look at that later on. The iron concentration or electrolytes or salt concentration of the blood is really important. It affects water potential, and the ions in your blood affect the functioning of the cells and affect nervous transmission and all sorts of other things. And your kidneys are really important in controlling the concentrations of those. Those are sort of the main ones, especially the top three, the main ones that are in your specification that you need to be aware of. But you've also got things like your oxygen concentration, which is needed for aerobic respiration. Obviously, that's to do with your lungs. And you've got carbon dioxide concentration, because that's a waste product of aerobic respiration. It is toxic if it builds up to high levels because it affects the pH of your blood. And again, the lungs will be involved in getting rid of that excess carbon dioxide. And then you've got a broad group here of toxic chemicals. So urea, which is produced from the breakdown of amino acids, as we'll see, again, I keep saying this, we'll see this later on in our later lessons. And also alcohol, drugs, lactic acid from anaerobic respiration, all of these chemicals are damaging to cells if they're at high levels. Okay, so you need to get rid of them. So generally the big organs involved there are your liver and the kidneys for excreting them in your urine. Okay, so you might want to spend a few minutes now just jotting down some of those ideas into your notes. Okay, so I'm just going to introduce some terms to you. We're not going to go into huge amounts of detail now, but you might want to write these ideas down as we go through. And then we'll look at, in detail at some of the idea of a stimulus. So, key thing that's going on with this whole topic is thinking about keeping things in your body under control. And the term homeostasis is about maintaining the internal environment in a constant state. And what we mean by that is within set limits. So if you think about it, your body temperature isn't ever completely constant. Okay, sometimes you're warmer, sometimes you're cooler, but it's maintained within very tight limits around about 37 degrees centigrade Celsius. And that's despite changes in the environment around you. As long as the conditions are not too extreme, your body temperature remains relatively constant. Your core body temperature, your skin temperature can actually fluctuate hugely, but your core body temperature remains fairly constant. Similarly with your blood glucose level. Even if you have been fasting for periods, for example, during Ramadan, or you're just not able to eat for a particular length of time, your blood glucose levels may well fall, but they will be maintained within certain limits. And similarly, when those athletes were running their race there, their blood glucose levels will be used up by their muscle cells, but your body will be acting to try and maintain that blood glucose level, because actually your brain can only respire glucose. It has to be supplied with it all the time via the blood. So this idea of maintaining things within set limits, keep things in balance. Okay, and we have this principle called negative feedback. And when we look at temperature control, and when we look at glucose control, which we will look at in a few lessons time, you will see an idea of a negative feedback loop, which is a way that if there is a change away from normal, either above or below normal, so if your body temperature goes above normal or goes below normal, something will happen. Your body will respond in some way to bring about change back to normal level. Okay, and that's called negative feedback. There is also something called positive feedback, and positive feedback will result in increases in change in the body. Okay, so things moving further away from that set point. It's a bit like a microphone making a squealing sound. You know, the feedback you get sometimes with microphones and speakers, where the sound goes into the microphone, gets amplified, goes out the speaker, gets picked up again, and goes round and round and round, gets more and more out of control. And actually, positive feedback is not used hugely in living systems because of that issue, that it results in a runaway change, basically. But sometimes it's important, for example, in childbirth, in pushing a baby out through the cervix. So anyway, let's think about, well, if we're going to have these controls to keep things relatively constant despite change in the external environment, that could be the external environment as in around the whole organism or even with around cells, we need to be able to detect what's going on. Okay, and your body has two systems that allow you to detect changes in the external or internal environment. And things that can change and be detected are called stimuli, and we'll look at those in a moment. And your body is able to coordinate our behavior. And what we mean by behavior is physiological changes or maybe just physical behaviors to bring about a response, which is something your body does in order to maintain homeostasis or prevent you being killed or damaged or in some way. Okay, and we have two systems which are called your nervous system, which we're going to look at in detail over the next couple of lessons, but you've also got the hormonal system, which is also called the endocrine system. So just give yourself 3 minutes to add any ideas to your notes on what I've just talked about, any of the last two slides. Try and think about what I've talked about, add it into your notes. Okay, so what we think about is, how many senses do you have? I want you to write down as many things you can think of that your senses, and what the stimulus is. Okay, have a think, give yourself 2 minutes. Okay, so how many senses do you think you have?
I sense a buzzer coming. 5 or 3.
Ooh.
6, 7, 8, 9, 4, 3, 2, 1. 10, 11.
9, anything between 9 and 21, yeah. I'll give you points.
Oh, oh.
Just think about what one means by
seeing,
Aristotle said
hearing,
5.
Tasting, smelling, touching.
Right. So what about balance? What about hunger? What about thirst? Why aren't they senses? Feedback from your relationship with the world. Pressure.
Disappointment.
there are other ones. Feeling heat. Where do you feel heat? You don't touch heat. So there is thermoception, nociception, which is pain, equilibrioception, which
so
is balance.
So why do they teach me that there are 5?
Well, it was Aristotle who said it. He said there were 4 elements, but, you know, earth, air, fire and water, but we don't believe that now. But I do.
I go along with that.
But there's also proprioception, which is if you close your eyes and move your hand about, you know where it is.
What about the sixth sense?
That's right. Yeah, it's an old phrase because in those days they only thought of 5 senses.
So what, it should be the 22nd sense?
Do you know where it is?
How are you doing that?
I don't know. It's like some strange power. Where is my arm? Oh, I don't know. I knew this, but he fell asleep, he was drunk. You know, sometimes you fall asleep and your arm does something a bit weird like that. And he fell asleep like that, and he woke up, and he went, oh, like that, and his arm dropped down, and he broke his nose. Pretty bad, you know.
Okay, so hopefully that little video just sort of showed you that we have many more than the sort of 5 senses that we think about, and actually even within the ones we're going to look at, they can be broken down. But your specification talks about the main senses your body detects in terms of your nervous system, but we will also think about other things that your body can detect. So, for example, being able to detect blood glucose concentration, that is a sense. We don't think about it as a sense, but your body is able to detect your blood glucose levels to try and maintain it. Okay, but you might want to build up a table now of the different senses and what the stimuli are and what the organs are. Okay, so we've obviously got sight, and hopefully you got the idea that in your eyes, you may not remember, but you've got rods and cone cells, and again, this is a link back to that our cells unit, specialized cells in the retina, in the eye, that detect light. Okay, so we've got light energy being detected. You've got the sense of hearing, which is you have these specialized hair cells in the cochlea of your ear, and they are able to detect sound vibrations. Taste is detected on your tongue, so that's, and when we think about taste, oh, sweet, sour, bitter, you can actually sort of see what sort of taste can you detect. And really, you've only got 5 tastes you can detect on your tongue, and that's to do with chemicals in food and water. Okay, but you've got all the other things that make up taste are actually really smell, which is detected by your nose. And again, it's chemicals, but this time sort of in aerosol form, so in the air. But when you're eating food and you think, oh, this tastes really nice, actually what you're doing is smelling a lot of it, because all you can really taste is sweet, sour, salt, bitter, and umami, which is like a meaty flavor, okay? And all the other bits come from the, when you bite into food, the chemicals being released and sort of traveling up into your nasal passage and being detected by the chemoreceptors in your nose. All right. When you have a cold, you might notice that you sort of lose the sense of smell and sense of taste a little bit. Everything seems to taste bland, and that's because you're not really smelling the food as well, because you've got so much mucus from the cold, whatever it is, that's blocking the chemoreceptors. And the smells aren't getting there. okay? Slightly gross thing. If you do sometimes blow your nose, if you have a lot of mucus there and blow your nose sometimes the mucus may have trapped chemicals from what things you've smelled previously, and suddenly you get a burst of whatever that smell was, whether it was pleasant or not. Just a little gross thought there for you, because those chemicals are suddenly getting in contact with the chemoreceptors in your nose. Okay, and obviously in your mouth you've got your taste buds which detect those different chemicals. There used to be a thing that different parts of your mouth detect different tastes, and actually that's not true. All parts of your tongue detect all the different five chemical types. Okay, you've also got touch, which is a really broad term, because actually your skin is able to detect lots of things. Okay, it's able to detect touch and pressure and pain, but you've also got thermoreceptors in your skin which can detect temperature, and you've got different ones. You can some detect low temperatures and some seem to be stimulated by high temperatures. You've got pain, itch, okay, but you've also got hunger, thirst. So hunger would be maybe your sense in your stomach going that's empty, but also it might be your body having low blood glucose level. Okay, thirst, being slightly dehydrated, can also be mistaken for hunger as well. So if you ever think, oh, I'm really hungry, maybe have a little drink of water and see whether that gets rid of it. Proprioception, we talked about this idea of knowing where your body organs are. You could actually have a go at this at home. You know, just close your eyes now and touch your middle finger to your nose or something like that. Without looking, you know where your hand is, so you can control where it's going to touch. Okay, you can scratch and touch parts of your body you can't see, so you must know, your body organs must know where they are in relation to the rest of your body. You've also got balance, so you've got the ability to detect gravity in your ears. You have the semicircular canals that sort of have liquid in them that slosh about and level out due to gravity, and that allows you to know which sort of way you are up. You can also detect your blood pressure. You don't physically know about it, but your brain is coordinating that. Okay, and it's able to detect pressure in your blood vessels. Okay, so you've got loads of different stimuli. The ones in the table at the top are the most important, but obviously you have got other ones as well. You might want to put some of the terms that I've mentioned, like chemoreceptors, thermoreceptors, into your table as well. So give yourself 5 to 10 minutes to add ideas to your notes. And that's it. Thank you very much.